Hello learners, welcome to NIOS. Today, we will take up a fresh topic of your history syllabus. We will study lesson number 6 from the module on Ancient India. The title of the chapter is Post-Mauryan Developments. In the previous lesson, we learned about the formation of the Mahajanapadas and later formation of the Mauryan Empire. In today's lesson, we shall study about the political and cultural condition in the Indian subcontinent from the end of the Maurya Empire to the rise of the Guptas, that is, from 200 BC to 300 AD. Learners, by the end of this lesson, you will be able to understand the following things. Those political regions which came into prominence after the decline of the Mauryan Empire. You will also know about those foreigners who came from Central Asia and settled here. The growth of trade between the Roman and Indian empires. You will also learn about the important features of various schools of art and sculptures which emerged during 200 BC to 300 BC. And you will also learn about the early history of South India and Sangam literature. Learners, at the end of this lesson, I will be asking you 3 questions from what you will study today. Let us begin by understanding about the political history of North India. The disintegration of the Mauryan Empire led to the rise of many regional kingdoms in different parts of the country. At the same time, India was invaded by various groups coming from Central Asia and Western China. These were Indo-Greeks, the Scythians or the Shakas, the Parthians or the Pahlavas, and the Kushanas. We will learn about the Sungas first. The last Mauryan king, Brihadratha, was killed by his commander-in-chief, Pushyamitra Shung, who established his own dynasty, which came to be known as the Sunga dynasty or the Shunga dynasty. While the Shungas were ruling in North India, the Indo-Greeks, also known as Yavanas, became powerful in Bactria or Balkh during the second quarter of the 1st century BC. The last of the Shunga rulers was killed by his minister Vasudeva, who founded the Kanva dynasty. Now we will learn about the Bactrians or the Indo-Greeks. After the death of Alexander in 323 BC, many Greeks came to settle on the northern. Repeat, after the death of Alexander in 323 BC, many Greeks came to settle on the northwestern borders of India. Bactria or Afghanistan had large population of these Greek people. They came to be called the Bactrian Greeks. The most famous Indo-Greek ruler was Menander. His empire included southern Afghanistan and Gandhara, the region west of the river Indus. Buddhist texts call him Milinda. Milinda Panho, written by Nagasena, contains philosophical questions that Milind asked Nagasena and informs us that, impressed by the answers, the king accepted Buddhism as his religion. Shaka or Scythians originally came from Central Asia. They were Yuchi tribesmen who came to settle in northwestern India, the 1st century BC. Their territories extended up to Mathura and Gujarat. The most famous of all the Shaka rulers was Rudradaman, who ruled in the middle of 2nd century AD. His empire was spread over almost whole of western India. We know about him from the Junagadh inscription. We will now study about the Parthians. The Parthians were of Iranian origin and had close relations with Shakas. Therefore, they are also known as Shaka Pahlava. Gondopharnes was an important Parthian ruler. The Takht-e-Bahi inscription recovered from Mardan near Peshawar mentions about him. The Kushanas originally belonged to Yuchi tribe of China. They created a big empire in Pakistan after defeating Shakas and Pahlavas. The first important Kushana king was Kujula Kadphises. He was succeeded by his son Vema Kadphises. Next ruler was Kanishk. He was the most famous of the Kushanas. He probably ascended the throne in 78 AD. Kanishka started a new era, now known as the Shaka era. Right now, you can see the Kanishka statue, which has been found in the Mathura Museum. Kanishka's empire extended from Central Asia to North India and included Varanasi, Kaushambi, and Shravasti in Uttar Pradesh. His greatness lies in integrating Central Asia with North India as part of a single empire. It resulted in the intermingling of different cultures and increase in trade. Kanishka is famous in history as a great patron of Buddhism. The fourth Buddhist council at Kundalvana or Kashmir was held during his reign. In this council, Buddhism was divided into two schools, Hinayana and Mahayana. Kanishka also patronized the Gandhara and Mathura schools of art. He also built the city of Purushpur, that is present-day Peshawar, and made it his capital. We will now learn about the Kushana administration. Learners, we do not know much about the administrative machinery of the Kushanas. Perhaps the whole empire was divided into provinces, each ruled by a Mahakshatrapa or a military governor who was assisted by a Kshatrapa. We are told by sources that Kushana horsemen wore trousers while riding. A prominent feature of Kushana kings used the title of Devaputra, that is, son of God, thus claiming divinity. The Kushanas occupy a special place in the ancient Indian history because of their contribution to various aspects of life. Their vast empire helped in the growth of internal as well as external trade. It resulted in the rise of new urban centers. Large number of gold and copper coins have been found, which suggest a robust economy. India made progress in literature and medicine also. Charak, known as father of Ayurveda, wrote a book on medicine called Charaka Samhita, whereas Ashwaghosha, that is a Buddhist scholar, wrote Buddha Charita, a full-length biography of the Buddha. Both these scholars were believed to be the contemporaries of King Kanishka. The Kushanas patronized the Gandhara and the Mathura schools of sculptural art, which are known for producing the earliest images of Buddha and Bodhisattvas. Invasions of the Bactrian Greeks and the Saka Pahlavas on India and its subsequent political contact with Central Asia under the Kushanas resulted in immense cultural intermingling between the two regions. These foreign groups gradually lost their foreign identity and were incorporated in the Brahminical society, lower grade as Kshatriyas. Many of them adopted Buddhism. We have already referred to the Indo-Bactrian ruler Menander, who was converted to Buddhism by a monk named Nagasena. Central Asian contacts also brought to India new methods of making coins. The crude punch-marked coins, which were used earlier, gradually gave way to refined Greek-style coins containing legends and the bust of the ruler. This new format became the model for the subsequent coinage in India. Besides, Indians also borrowed from Central Asians, particularly the Greeks, knowledge of astronomy. On your TV screens, you can right now see Indo-Greek coins. Early Indian literary works on astronomy frequently quote the Greek astronomers who are referred to as Yavanacharya. Indians also learned the art of making horoscopes from the Greeks. Central Asian contacts brought a fresh wave in the art of sculpture making. Buddhist sculptures of the Gandhara school, as explained here below, evolved as a result of the amalgamation of the Indian and the Greek styles. We know that the Deccan as well as eastern India were parts of Ashoka's empire. He had conquered Kalinga through a violent battle in which loss of men and property was enormous. It was as a result of the Mauryan rule in these regions that after its decline, we noticed the emergence of kingdoms in Kalinga and the Deccan for the first time in the Indian history. After Ashoka, Kalinga, that is modern-day Orissa, rose under the kings of the Chedi dynasty. Kharuvela's achievements are recorded in the Hathi Gumpha inscription in the Udaygiri hills near Bhubaneswar in Orissa. This inscription tells us that Kharuvela was a follower of Jainism and had fought many successful battles against his neighbors. This is the Hathi Gumpha cave that you are watching on your TV screen right now. Now we will study about the Satavahanas of the Deccan. Satavahanas became prominent in Indian politics during the middle of the 1st century BC. Gautamiputra Satakarni of 1st century AD is considered to be the greatest of the Satavahana rulers. His kingdom extended from River Krishna in south to River Godavari in the north. This is a coin of Gautamiputra Satakarni, Pratishthana, that is modern Pathan, near Aurangabad in Maharashtra, was the capital of Satavahanas. The Satavahanas were succeeded by the kings of the Ikshvaku dynasty. Satavahana kingdom was divided into subdivisions called Aharas or Rashtras, meaning districts. The lowest level of administration was a Grama, which was under the charge of a Gramika. There were also officers called Amatyas, who were perhaps ministers or advisors of the king. Revenue was collected both in cash and in kind. Satavahana kings were the first in Indian history to make tax-free land grants to Buddhists and Brahmanas to gain religious merit. This practice became more prominent in succeeding periods. The Satavahana kings claimed to be the Brahmanas and considered it their primary duty to uphold Varna system, that is, the fourfold division of social structure. Learners, let us first study about the internal and external trade routes. During the post-Mauryan period, trade and commerce grew, both internally as well as externally. There were two major internal land routes in ancient India. First, known as Uttarapath, that connected northern and eastern parts of India with the northwestern parts, that is, present-day Pakistan. And the second, known as Dakshinapath, that connected the peninsular India with the western and northern parts of India. As far as external trade is concerned, after the discovery of monsoons by Hippalus, that is a Greek navigator in 45 AD, more and more sea voyages were used for trading purposes. Important ports of India on the western coast were Bhrigukachha, Sopara, Kalyan, Mujiris, etc. Ships from these ports sailed to the Roman Empire through the Red Sea. Trade was also conducted with Southeast Asia. Prominent ports on the eastern coast of India were Tamralipti in West Bengal, Arikamedu in Tamil Nadu coast, etc. Sea trade prevailed between Bhrigukachha and the ports of Southeast Asia. During post-Mauryan period, we had thriving trade between India and the West. Initially, this trade was carried out through land, but since Persians caused troubled sea routes were used. Now ships could move directly from Indian ports to the ports on Red Sea and Persian Gulf. Periplus of the Erythraean Sea gives a detailed account of Indo-Roman trade. Romans demanded Indian products such as spices, perfumes, jewels, ivory, textiles like muslin, etc. The spice trade with the Roman Empire was largely based in South India. Romans also imported several precious and semi-precious stones like diamond, carnelian, turquoise, agate, sapphire, etc., besides pearls, indigo, sandalwood, and steel, etc. Now we will look into the art and architecture. Learners, art in the post-Mauryan period was basically religious. Two most important features of art and architecture of this period are the stupas and development of regional schools of sculpture. Lord Buddha's idols were carved out for the first time in this period. On account of contact with the foreigners from Northwest, a new school of art called Gandhara School of Art developed. It was greatly influenced by the Greek style. We will first study about stupas in more detail. A stupa was a large hemispherical dome with a central chamber in which relics of the Buddha or some Buddhist monks were kept in a small casket. The base was surrounded by a path for clockwise circumambulation, that is, pradakshina, enclosed by wooden railings which were later made of stone. Three prominent stupas of this period are at Bharhut and Sanchi, both in Madhya Pradesh, and Amaravati and Nagarjunakonda, both in Andhra Pradesh. This is a stupa that you can see on your TV. A number of stupas were also constructed in South India during this period, but none of them is present today. The Amaravati stupa in Andhra Pradesh took its final shape during the 2nd century AD. The sculptures on stupas are drawn on the themes based on Jataka and other Buddhist stories. Now we will learn about the rock cut architecture of post-Mauryan period. A lot of progress took place in rock cut architecture. A large number of temples, halls and places of residence for monks were cut out of the solid rocks near Pune and Nashik in Maharashtra under the Satavahanas. The place of worship generally had a shrine cell with a votive stupa placed in the center. This place was known as Achaitya, and the rock cut structure used as the residence for monks was called a vihara. This is Achaitya, image of Achaitya that you can see on your screen. Buddhism was divided into two parts, Hinayana and Mahayana. Mahayana Buddhism encouraged Buddha's worship as a god in human form. As a result of this, a large number of Buddha images were built in different regions. There were three major schools of sculptural art which developed in this period. These were the Mathura School of Art, Gandhara School of Art, and Amaravati School of Art. We will first learn about the Mathura School of Art in more detail. Learners, in the Mathura School, artists used local red stone with black spots to make the images. Mathura has also yielded large numbers of sculptures of Jaina deities. During the Kushana period, a number of sculptures of Hindu deities were carved, like Kartikeya, Vishnu, Kuber, etc. Now we will look into the Gandhara School of Art. Learners, the Gandhara form of art also became famous in the northwestern part of the Indian subcontinent. This region was successively ruled by the Greeks, Mauryas, Sungas, Shakas, and Kushanas for many centuries. The Gandhara school is also called Greco-Roman, Indo-Greek, or Greco-Buddhist because it had all these influences, that is, Roman, Greek, and Indian. Now we will study about the Amaravati School of Art in more detail. The Amaravati School of Art flourished in the region of Andhra Pradesh. The main patrons of this form were the Satavahanas. An important feature of Amaravati art is the use of white marble-like stone to carve out the figures. Learners, we will now discuss early history of South India. In South India, the Neolithic phase was succeeded by the Megalithic period. Megaliths were tomb spots consisting of burial or graves covered with huge or mega stones. These megaliths have been found in large numbers from the Nagpur area in Maharashtra and other places in South India. The Megalithic period in South India was followed by the Sangam Age. The Sangam Age refers to that period in the early history of South India when large numbers of poems in Tamil were composed by a number of authors. The term Sangam refers to an assembly or meeting together of Tamil poets. Three Sangams or assemblies are believed to have been convened one after the other. All the three Sangams took place at different places under the patronage of the Pandya kings of Madurai. Poems within the Sangam literature were composed on themes of love and war. Tamilaham or Tamil country stretched from the hills of Tirupati up to Kanyakumari. The important chieftains who dominated Tamil region during Sangam age were the Cholas with Urayur as their capital, the Cheras with their capital at Vanji, and Pandyas with their capital at Madurai. Tamilaham was divided into five Thinais or ecozones, that is, these were Kurinji, hilly region, Palai, arid zone, Mullai, pastoral tracts, Murudam, wetlands, and Nittal, sea coast. People were known on the basis of their occupation. The rich lived in well-decorated brick houses and wore costly clothes, whereas the poor lived in mud huts and were scantily dressed. Women in the Sangam period appear to have been educated. However, the practice of sati was also prevalent in Tamil society, and it was known as Thippayadal. The people were engaged in various economic activities such as agriculture, crafts and trade. Paddy was the most important crop. It formed the main part of people's diet and also served as a medium of barter exchange for inland trade. The Chola king Karikala of the Sangam age is credited with constructing a dam on the river Kaveri. It is considered to be the earliest dam in the country. The Sangam people had flourishing trade with the Romans. This is confirmed by the recovery of a large number of Roman gold coins in South India. In the field of religion, Brahmanism was popular in South. Buddhists and Jains also existed in Tamil region. The local people, particularly those of the hills, worshipped a deity called Murugan. Okay, learners, now that we have reached the end of this lesson, let me ask you the three questions that I had promised in the beginning based on your study of today's lesson. All the best. The first question is that the last Mauryan king, Brihadratha, was killed by his commander-in-chief. What was his name? Keep writing them down. In the end, I'll give you the answers also. Now comes the question number two. Gautamiputra Satakarni belonged to which dynasty? I hope it's a very easy question. All of you all will be able to answer this. Now, it's time for question number three. Tamilaham was divided into five Thinais or ecozones. What is the meaning of Kurinji? Yeah, so these are your three questions. Now, let us look into the answers to these questions. The answer to the first question is, as you can see on your TV screen, Pushyamitra Sunga. Answer to question number two is Satavahana dynasty. And answer to question number three is hilly region. Kurinji is hilly region. Okay, so this brings us to the close of today's video lesson. And I hope you liked today's lesson. Thanks for watching. Goodbye.